This is BBC One. Now the start of Wimbledon 81.
Good afternoon. The 95th Wimbledon Championships begin in just about 5 minutes' time, and already, as you look at these pictures, you can see it's clear that the magic of Wimbledon is as compelling as ever. There were queues here even overnight for places on the centre court, and long lines of people waiting to get in when I arrived here shortly before noon. And of course, apart from the championships, what's brought them out is the sun. The forecast is marvellous, dry and sunny throughout, and the outlook for tomorrow, dry, warm and sunny. Well, for the third year running, Wimbledon has a new look. 2 years ago, they literally raised the roof of the centre court. Last year, there was play on four new courts. And since last year, there's been a £3 million facelift on number one court, which we're moving into now. You can see that it's been raised to the level of the centre court alongside it. Now, there's a whole new restaurant, bar, all sorts of changing facilities being incorporated there, and a new player's balcony. This is it, where the players can wait in comfort before they play their matches, looking out over the main concourse. All sorts of facilities for ball boys, ball girls, for lady competitors, changing rooms. A whole new complex has been built on number one court. And if we go inside, we see how the new stands have been erected to provide more seats. There are an extra 1,250 seats available now on number one court. And it gives us an improved new camera position. And we've changed ends, in fact, with our camera. And we look down on number one court. We can show you what's in store for people there this afternoon. Tom Gullickson, the left-hander from the United States, plays the number two seed, last year's runner-up, John McEnroe. John Lloyd, unseeded from Great Britain, plays the 31-year-old Phil Dent of Australia, also unseeded. And the number 10 seed, Guillermo Vilas of Argentina, left-hander, plays Mark Edmondson of Australia, who won at Bristol at the weekend, of course. All men's singles today. Now then, let's turn our attention to the centre court, because the champion and his opponent today coming on court, Bjorn Borg. Of course, the champion traditionally opening play on the centre court, the man who this year will be attempting to win Wimbledon for the sixth time running. Bow to the Royal Box, where the Duchess of Kent is watching. And this...
The curtain goes up on BBC Two's coverage of Wimbledon 81 in just 2 minutes. You're watching BBC Two. The time is exactly 20 past two.
Good afternoon. Wimbledon 81 got underway here some 20 minutes ago in front of huge crowds enjoying warm sun. People actually queued here overnight out on the pavements outside Wimbledon to get the treasured few places on the centre court. By 11. Well now, we usually try to give you at the end of our transmissions in the Wimbledon fortnight a glimpse of things we've put together, what we call the sights and sounds of the Wimbledon fortnight. What a fortnight it is. One more final to come, the mixed doubles. News of that in Match of the Day at 9:05. Hope you've enjoyed all our transmissions. Our final memory, McEnroe the champion.
This is BBC One, and it's now 9:55. Time to join Harry Carpenter for the start of Wimbledon 82.
Welcome to Wimbledon 1982. And just 5 minutes before play begins, huge crowds already packing the 18 famous Wimbledon courts as the world's premier championship gets underway. Queues began forming here quite early this morning, people waiting for the gates to open at noon. And this year we have a different Wimbledon because for the first time this great championship is scheduled to last 13 days instead of 12 with a Sunday finish. And the championships open under grey skies. It's a dull, overcast day. The forecast is it'll be dry much of the time. We may get some rain or drizzle, but it won't be prolonged. Well, no matter what the weather, already in these opening moments, the traditional Wimbledon garden party atmosphere well established. Half a ton of strawberries and cream probably already consumed. And the champagne, obviously, well chilled. But competitively, Wimbledon does have a strange look this year. There's no Bjorn Borg. For the first time in 5 years, it's...
will be going live to Wimbledon for coverage of the first day of the Lawn Tennis Championships. But first, some music. This is BBC Two, and now we join Harry Carpenter for live coverage of the first day of Wimbledon 1982.
Good afternoon and welcome to Wimbledon 1982, where play started some 20 minutes ago. And the two great show courts, the centre court and number one court, packed to capacity. But some of those outside courts are not quite so well patronised at the moment. It may well be that the London tube strike has affected this first day's attendance a little. 13 days of Wimbledon this year, not 12, finish on a Sunday. The weather, well, it's grey and overcast, ideal for the players. And the forecast is dull and dry most of the day. There might be a little rain, but it's not expected to be prolonged. One or two gaps on those outside courts, as you can see. Now, let's look at the men's seedings. Of course, John McEnroe is the number one seed this year, no Borg. McEnroe defeated Borg in the final last year and is seeded one. Jimmy Connors seeded two. Those two, of course, seeded to meet in the singles final. And the only British seed, of course, is Buster Mottram, and he's seeded number one.
This is BBC One North.
Well, of course they will. Yeah. Mind you, I don't understand football.
Thanks very much.
Hello. Who's the best player of all the teams that you've seen in the world?
They've been the Brazilians, haven't they? You know, like, Brazilians play football like shopping at Harrods. Our team play football as shopping at Marks and Spencer's. You get the difference?
I do get
it. It's shuffle, but it's there. Yeah. One's the elite milk chocolate, the other's plain chocolate, isn't it? But nevertheless, they're struggling and they deserve all they get. Yeah. Anyway, put some more in.
All right, I'll put a bit more in there for you. Lovely. Yeah.
All right.
Jim gets everywhere, doesn't he? Well, now I'll look ahead to Scotland's most important game for years against the Supplement. Tonight in World Cup Grandstand, starting BBC One at 7:40 when we cover the match live. See you then. Hope you sleep well. Bye-bye.
Earlier this evening, the Princess of Wales gave birth to a baby boy, and we would like to offer our congratulations to the Prince and Princess of Wales. Tomorrow morning, BBC One will be opening up at 9 o'clock with a news summary, and if there is any more news about mother and baby, we'll bring it to you then. Now, the time is 13 minutes past 12, 13 minutes past midnight, and BBC One is closing down. So on behalf of all of us here, this is Peter Brook wishing you a very good night.
Went to see them.
It's Wimbledon's most rugged ritual, an ordeal that appeals to the competitive spirit. 150 centre court seats will be sold daily on a first-come, first-served basis. And first-come, queuing for the eighth year in succession, is businessman Richard Walters, who's flown over for the occasion from Canada.
Will you queue every night?
For the first nine nights of the tournament, I will, but there's no queuing for the last four.
Good morning.
What's all the noises have been in there?
Very good.
Very
warm.
Well. We've been like a greenhouse.
Is it worth spending a cold night on the pavement?
Oh, yes.
It's quite fun, really. You get to see the same people every year. You see the same regular faces, or have a yearly get-together.
Is it going to be worth it?
Yes. Yeah, as long as I see John McCool. It's okay.
Now, with the time at 1:45, we pay our first visit to Wimbledon 83. Dispute were unable to show coverage of the World Cup cricket match between England and Sri Lanka. However, Radio 3 Medium Wave is on the air now with commentary from today's matches. Now on BBC 2, we go to Wimbledon for coverage of the opening day of the 1983 Lawn Tennis Championships.
Wimbledon 83 already underway. Play began here at 12:30 today on the outside courts and will do so every day this first week, breaking the long Wimbledon tradition of a 2 o'clock start. The reason? The ladies' championship has been extended this year from 96 players to 128, same as the men's, and the early start is necessary, of course, to accommodate those extra matches. And because of the early start, we already have one important result through. The number 13 seed in the men's singles, Brian Gottfried of the United States, has come through on number 2 court in his match against Shlomo Glickstein of Israel, 6-1, 6-4, 6-4. So that's the first important news of a seed today. Let's look at the seedings in the men's championship. And there we are.
On the dispute that's hit BBC outside broadcasts began this afternoon, soon after the first play at Wimbledon. The two sides gathered at the conciliation service ACAS in London. The troubles over the expenses paid to staff when they stay in hotels. It affected Royal Ascot last week, and today there were no pictures of the Prudential Cup cricket at Headingley. But Wimbledon went ahead as planned. The cameramen were there for the start of about 100 hours of pictures from this year's tournament. The talks at ACAS are still going on. The tennis at Wimbledon was in perfect conditions, but with the spectators asking how the players would react to the tougher code of conduct promised by the officials. As Michael Blakey reports, two famous players...
But it is due to touchdown at the Edwards Air Force Base very shortly. And I understand we can go live in vision now to California. And our man this end in our new studio here will be James Wilkinson.
Just about an hour ago, the Challenger fired its engines to begin the deorbiting maneuver. Then at about 2:30, it began its re-entry into the Earth's atmosphere, and we had the usual communications blackout. That lasted for about 16 minutes, and then a short while ago, Challenger was picked up by television cameras on high-flying aircraft. And it's down. Kicking up sand and dust, that's quite a nuisance for them, of course, because it usually causes odd nicks and scratches in the delicate heat-resistant tiles on the belly of the shuttle. And those, of course, have to be repaired before it can go into space again.
And Challenger's back home, back to Earth. The unofficial touchdown time... in mission elapsed time, 6 days, 2 hours, 24 minutes, 10 seconds.
That's Wimbledon and Harry Carpenter.
Thanks very much. Not quite sunbaked here, but we're hoping. We're going straight back to the centre court and that match between Rodney Harmon, the non-seed, and the number 12 seed.
And now on BBC One, the first of this year's visits to the All England Tennis Club for the beginning of Wimbledon 84.
Wimbledon 84 is underway. The gate swung back at noon and thousands of people, some of whom had been queuing for many hours, streamed through on this warm and humid day to take their places around the world's most famous tennis courts. And play began today on the outside courts at 12:30. So these people here, and millions of you at home, are ready again to savour the sights and sounds of Wimbledon. The title.
My bluff when the two teams consist of Susan Hill and Nigel Havers with Frank Muir and Paul Eddington and Angela Thorne with Arthur Marshall. At 8:30 we begin a second showing of the serial set at the time of the fall of Singapore in 1941 when the British and colonial women on the island were left to the far from tender mercies of the Japanese in Tenko. Moving forward in time to 1958, Bernadette Short stars as Maureen, carried away on the wings of love in a new comedy series, Round and Round, at 9:25. Then at 9:55, Diary of a Maasai Village follows the events in the life of one village in Kenya. And Newsnight is at 10:45. This is BBC Two. And now we join Harry Carpenter for day one of Wimbledon 84.
Good afternoon and welcome to to this first day of Wimbledon 84. Play began here at 12:30 today on the outside courts that you're looking at now, in front of huge crowds. They absolutely poured through the gates when they opened at noon today, and we have a beautifully warm day, rather humid in fact, and almost no wind at all. Well, both men and women are playing today, but it's the men who hold the stage on the two show courts. We can show the order of play now first.
Well, in about 5 minutes, we'll be joining Sarah Brown in her vegetarian kitchen, where a brown rice salad with herbs is on the menu. Before that, here's our news summary with Ian Smith.
Good evening. The headline: striking miners have had only limited success in stopping rail deliveries to steelworks. Supplies appear to have been reaching most steelworks today as normal. At Llanwern, three of the day's supply trains went into the South Wales works unhindered. A fifth was later cancelled. Only one train carrying 3,000 tonnes of iron ore was stopped at the picket line outside. Two miners working at Bilston Glen Pit near Edinburgh were attacked as they left work tonight. They were trying to pass through a 300-strong picket line. Their injuries aren't known. Earlier, there were 50 arrests as the pickets tried to prevent men returning to work. The NCB says that 38 men went in, enough to ensure that coal was produced. The NUM disputes the figure. It says only 13 crossed the picket lines without permission. The NCB is again invoking the law in connection with the miners' strike. It's been granted leave to seek a High Court order to evict strikers occupying a Kent pit. Police say that a man is helping with inquiries after a two-year-old died in a hit-and-run accident. The girl's body was found a mile from the scene near Beaconsfield, and police are examining a car.
Winning team, perhaps whilst they're enjoying their celebrations, let me just say on behalf of everybody, the one thing we always want you to do is to keep dancing. Goodbye.
Tomorrow on BBC One, Bernard Falk introduces a new series of Now Get Out of That.
How can we forget Zeke? They'll never forget this. And those who took part in it are bound to remember that. And we're back for a new series of five programmes in which we challenge two teams, one from Britain and one from America, to compete against the clock in a series of physical and mental puzzles. And the challenge from us to the teams is now... get out of that.
And that's tomorrow at 8:30.
Now on BBC One, Desmond Lynham introduces Match of the Day from Wimbledon 84.
Welcome to the first match of the day at Wimbledon 84 here on BBC One this year. Now, as you'd expect on this first day of the championships, most attention was focused on the number one seed and reigning men's champion.
Now we have a programme for the course on genetics. Today we look at some of the factors that influence genetic polymorphism in two types of snail. There'll be another programme for this course, Changing Britain, Changing World, in a fortnight's time when we'll be looking at industrialisation in Brazil.
Now on BBC One, we're off to Albert Square to catch up on all the week's news of London's EastEnders.
Wimbledon on BBC Television. The world's leading tennis players wrestle for the ultimate title of Wimbledon champion, watched by the BBC's top commentary team. The rich rewards, all part of BBC One and Two's exclusive coverage of the toughest test in tennis, with the best of the play in Match of the Day each evening on BBC One. World Beating Wimbledon, starting tomorrow on BBC Television.
Now the start of 2 weeks of top tennis in Wimbledon 85.
John McEnroe has won Wimbledon. Today he opens his 1985 defence, but it will be slightly delayed. Well, that flash of fire and that mighty roll of drums from heaven was the ominous prelude to Wimbledon 85 less than an hour ago. And this is the current scene on the centre court. Grey skies, a rainy day, and I'm afraid the centre court completely covered. Well, the weather forecast says that this is more or less what was expected. Considerable number of showers early on in the day, but they do tell us that things will improve later on. And although it'll be quite cool, they could play on, say the Met Office, until quite late into the evening as the weather improves. And I'm sure all those people under the umbrellas would love to know that, and also love to know that it is true. Well, what they're waiting to see, of course, is the arrival of the champion John McEnroe onto the court.
To a greeting from the heavens today, rain delayed play, but it didn't stop spectators from braving the weather. Michael Cole went to investigate.
Whatever Connors and McEnroe manage in the way of Thunderbolt services during this fortnight, they can't compete with this overhead delivery by Odin, or was it Thor? Thus, on Midsummer's Day, the British weather welcomed an expectant world to the All England Tennis Championships. The referee and head groundsman found the only dry spot in Southwest 19. It looked like a camping holiday in Snowdonia, but they were actually checking to see no water was getting onto the immaculate and so far unseen turf. Spectators pretended it was all a bad dream. It's 7 years since Wimbledon lost a full day through rain. If flaming June continues to splutter, play will start 2 hours early at noon to make up time.
And that was the 6 o'clock news on Monday, the 24th of June, as the rescuers continued their search for bodies from Air India Flight 182 off Southwest Ireland. Captain Michael Clark of the British Airline Pilots Association said all it takes is one man with a bomb and one sleepy security man.
As airline operators increased checks for bombs, one of them said it'll irritate the hell out of passengers, but it has to be done.
And in Toronto, an Indian, Surinder Bala, who'd earlier waved farewell to his wife, his son and his daughter, said, "I have lost everything." That's it from us. John Humphreys will be here with the 9 o'clock news. We'll see you tomorrow. Good night.
Now in daytime on two, some bits and pieces in Look, Look and Look Again. This is BBC Two. Now further coverage of Wimbledon 85, introduced by Harry Carpenter.
Good afternoon. The sound of rain hitting Wimbledon again for the second day and hitting it at this moment very hard indeed. People sheltering where they can. This is the heaviest rain I think we've seen in the 2 days so far. The covers, of course, are on everywhere. But let me tell you that we did have sunshine this morning, and in fact, play got underway as scheduled at 12:30 on the outside courts. But after just 40 minutes, the rain began, and it's hardly ceased since. This is the current scene on the centre court. A few moments ago, they raised that canvas into its familiar tent shape, which is always a sign that they expect fairly prolonged rain. However, when it does cease, and we're hopeful that we're going to get brighter weather a little later, this is the programme scheduled for trade on dark again. Just look out here behind me. The sky is absolutely black. I don't think it's going to last. It hasn't taken anybody by surprise, at least not the Met Office, because they warned us a few minutes ago that this was on its way, moving very slowly, they say, and should take about 20 minutes to pass over. They describe it as a very normal shower, but looking out there, that doesn't look too normal to me. Anyway, you will know, I dare say, that just before 2 o'clock this afternoon, we had the most amazing storm. It really was a fantastic rain and electrical storm. And, well, it was a bit frightening at times. However, our wizards in the videotape department have set about and set it all to music. Was recorded rain, but we've got real rain, I can assure you. It's thumping down on top of this studio roof here. Now, let me put you in the picture about the first of the semi-finals. It was only an hour and a half after all that lot that you've just seen. The play began on the centre court because they got the covers on early before the rain started, thanks to a warning from the Met Office. Anyway, Kevin Curran and Jimmy Connors came out to play their semi-final, and this was the result. Another tomorrow to the ladies' final and those other finals, but we end today still not knowing who will face Kevin Curran, the conqueror of the champions, in Sunday's men's final. From Wimbledon, good night.
Wimbledon by Harry Carpenter.
yesterday, 17-year-old Boris Becker keeping out of the ladies' singles final on the centre court. Today, Becker will be one of the central figures on this famous stage and set to make history in the men's singles final.
Welcome to day two of the 1986 Wimbledon Championships. The early demise of our test cricketers at Headingley means that we're totally tennis this afternoon, and I think we can promise you slightly better weather than yesterday. Well, the forecast tells us that we're going to get sunny intervals, maybe the odd shower, but nothing prolonged, and it's a little bit blustery out there today, but play did begin on time on the outside courts at 12:30.
Fiona Setterfield from Staffordshire.
What are these programmes? The people have been nice, haven't they?
They have. Thanks very much.
Thank you very much. Lots of nice letters and everything. And of course, there was that highly intelligent criticism of the programme from one of the papers, wasn't there?
Yes, I thought that showed deep insight, didn't you?
Deep insight. Mm. We didn't realise, did we, that this programme was all about the size of your ears and the size of my moustache.
Yes, I must say, that escaped me totally.
Shall we show them that little bit that we tried to do yesterday?
Yes, total disaster.
I don't know. Go on then.
A lot of nice response. Try and get it right, Lionel, will you? Oh, dear.
You get his moustache back.
What?
We could have been here for another three Wimbledons and never got that done, do we? Well, it's late at night. The people enjoy all that stuff. Well, we'll leave.
Latest news on the cricket at Lord's and tennis at Wimbledon, we cross now to Harry Carpenter.
Well, like Bernard the weatherman, I've got a window here that you can check on the weather, and you only have to see the spots of rain on it to know that it's still raining at Wimbledon. And now the news from Lord's, the second test between England and Pakistan. Those are the two umpires a few moments ago making an inspection of the pitch. David Constant and Alan Whitbread. This was just a few minutes ago. And with the umbrellas up, it doesn't look too promising. Still raining at Lord's, of course. David Constant. And the news they brought back with them as they squelched their way back to the pavilion was the play was abandoned for the day. So that means that that test lost all its play on Friday. Only 4 hours play was possible on Saturday. All of today lost. One more day to go, and that match looking now sure to end in a draw. Now let's look around here. No play at Lord's today, but we're still hoping that we might get some play later today. The news already is that the third and fourth matches on all courts have already been abandoned for the day. So the authorities here are beginning to have their doubts, obviously, about the way things are going. And it really has hardly stopped raining now since about 12 o'clock. However, there's no reason at all why we shouldn't bring you some tennis. We have all our recording facilities at the go, and what we're going to...
Well, now on BBC One, Harry Carpenter guides us through another afternoon at Wimbledon 87.
We'll be right back.
play is interesting today. The number one seeds both play on number one. The sights and sounds of Wimbledon tomorrow. Ladies' final, we look forward to that. By the way, one of our cameramen has been up on the steeple of St. Mary's Church all day, and I'm told he's found something completely different. Keep watching. Goodbye.
In a minute, the education programme. First, we're going over to the newsroom and Nicholas Witchell.
And the voyage of Richard Branson's balloon, the Atlantic Flyer, has ended in drama tonight. It hit the ground in Limavady in Northern Ireland. It lost some of its fuel tanks before rising into the skies again. And her two crewmen, Branson and Per Lindstrand, were forced to bail out from the balloon over the sea between Northern Ireland and the Mull of Kintyre in Scotland. Branson was picked up by the frigate HMS Argonaut. He's now being flown to hospital in Kilmarnock. His co-pilot, Lindstrand, has also been picked up from the sea and is now being taken to Port Rush. Clive Ferguson watched the balloon in trouble over the sea.
Look at the order of play. Well, it's... Oh, we're not going to take a look at the order of play, all right. Well, it's BBC Two, of course, tomorrow in Grandstand, and the final starts at 2 o'clock. We'll be on the air at 1:30 to bring you the build-up to that. Now, you know that... That advertising space I bought on the centre court.
Yes, that paid off.
Paid off. Seems to
excellent idea.
Seems to have worked an absolute treat as
excellent
far as I can
idea,
make out. Yes. Yes. What's he say? Best on? Well,
yes.
What can you say?
I didn't think your writing was very good, if you don't mind me saying.
Yes. They were rather expensive, actually. See you down at Wimbledon tomorrow.
Right.
Thanks very much indeed. Right, from tennis to cricket and up at Headingley. Good luck this afternoon. We're all set for the final, but first let me give you the other main sports news of the day, and it's that Nigel Mansell has won the French Grand Prix for the second year running. Nelson Piquet was second, Alain Prost was third, and that makes the world championship position look like this. Senna still leads, Mansell now in fourth position, but Senna's lead just 1 point, as you see, from Prost, and Piquet 2 points behind there, so it's very tight indeed. And the Constructors' Championship looks like this. Williams out front from...
Sets to last, 10-6, 6-2, 7-5.